What makes you happy?
Getting from one week to the other, not being broke.
Go to the theatre, go to the art gallery.
Being outdoors, poetry, writing.
Acting, that's my new passion. I love acting, I love making people laugh.
Going to the cinema, getting on a bus.
My dog, going to church.
Sports, football, I like running, I like computers.
Table tennis, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good?
Yeah, I'm not good.
Somewhere where you can get a snack and a coffee, like refreshments.
Being with my mate, sitting in the sunshine, not being sad and listening to good music.
I was, you know, content with giving my missus and my child money and looking after them.
People. I love people.
I'm learning to play drumkit.
I'm a massive Andy Murray fan, so yeah, I'm just brilliant, and that's on for 2 weeks.
Oh yeah, the seagulls come at 4 o'clock in the morning and I feed them. It's lovely.
I was homeless 10 months ago and I was actually sleeping in bins.
I had an argument with my mum and ended up sleeping rough outside.
I was in a 7-year marriage, which was a very abusive relationship.
I had a bit of arrears and they asked me to move out. And so then I moved in with that girl. The relationship broke down and so then I was homeless.
I became homeless after an eviction.
I don't know, just relationship breakups.
So I got kicked out when I was 20 because I didn't get on my sister.
I had to live with my mother and she died.
Split up with my partner.
My story is I've always had problems with alcohol.
My problems are due to mental health.
Well, I was with my partner. I was working in security. She was cheating.
We got a divorce.
I was under the age of 16, so the only choice was to go into social services, which I didn't want to do. So I chose to live by myself on the streets and fend for myself.
I was involved in crime from 12, 13, so it's ingrained into me.
I became slowly, over time, alcohol dependent. And part of the reason for that was trying to cope with the life that I had, but also the life that I'd had before, which had been very difficult. I have experienced physical hitting domestic abuse in my early life, but this was much more mental, psychological. It was about control.
The alcoholism just got too much for my wife to cope with. And I went to rehab, and whilst I was at rehab, I received a letter from a solicitor saying that I couldn't go back to the family home.
Basically, because she was a lead tenant, they then give me 3 months to appeal it and fight it. But because I wasn't working at the time, I was on benefits, I couldn't get no solicitor to fight my case unless I was paying them. So I lost the flat then.
Well, I've always been a loner, which caused me to sort of become introvert. And think negatively about situations, and due to life things, mainly family things, I didn't go for help, and so in the end I sort of lost everything.
Tried to stay in London, but I just could not afford it. It was too expensive. So I ended up having to move back where I had family, and when I moved up here, didn't have a place to stay, so I had 18 months just sofa surfing, living on the streets.
It'd be about 3 years ago now, I suppose. I was stuck in a rut. I was living in Didcot with now my ex-partner, and I was unemployed, but also taking care of her as an unpaid carer.
And having just come out of prison, it wasn't helping me. Plus my age was going against me, I believe.
I started when drinking when I was 14. Started the drugs when I was about 15. I've lost two families. Got three children. It's finally dawned on me after 22 years that it's not a good life. I've missed out so much with my children.
I've got a lot of, a lot of issues in my head, like insecure, things like that, and yeah, just, I stopped loving myself really, and I didn't really care about myself, and I had a good job, but I was just, every night, bottle of vodka and coke, and going into work, smelling of alcohol, and that eventually led to just not turning up, and then I couldn't pay my rent, so yeah, and then I just felt more worthless, pushed everyone away that cared about me, and just downward spiral, yeah.
I came from Iran in 2002, and I got the indefinite leave in the UK. And after that, I have been working for Churchill Hospital, working building job, and I have an accident. I got a depression, and I lost my job, and I couldn't have money to get the house or pay deposit or first month, and became homeless near 3 years now.
Yeah, I was outside the church selling drugs. She goes, I just want to talk to you about your life. I work for the church, have you got 5 minutes? So she just said to me, well, wouldn't you like a life, where a different life, where you could have the police over your back, you wouldn't selling drugs? I would love a life like that. But that ain't the real, you know, how am I going to get a life like that? If I goes, look, I can't just stop doing what I'm doing and coming to church. The people I work with, they're going to come to the house. If I don't hear from me in the night, if I don't phone up at the end of the night or tomorrow or after 2 days with money, and they're just going to come looking for me. You know, I can't just leave.
The control was so tight with things like money that eventually other people started noticing. I think it was at that point that one of the children's schools became involved, and they tried to get me support secretly from the domestic abuse services, and I started to see a domestic abuse worker, and she met me regularly over about a 6-7 month period, and she explained to me that she had a wheel of what abusing someone is, and everything was happening to me on the wheel except for the final part, which was being physically hit or beaten. And she talked with me about making escape plans if things escalated.
So I came to crisis, didn't know what was going to happen. I thought I was going to be judged. I thought it was my own fault. But I immediately received help, advice, and non-judgmental advice. I was put in touch with the outreach team, which I got verified, and so I could go onto day services first and then into the hostel system.
And I was literally sleeping at the back of our old cinema on the floor, on the pavement, and I was actually begging in my hometown, and for the shame of that, and I was losing it a bit. And then it took a mental breakdown in my local, in the Beacon in Banbury. And then they knew that I weren't very well, and then they took me to Chipping Norton and gave me a nice little place there, and then moved me to Owanlan House.
I had to work hard. I had to interact with the day service in the building, which allows you to do things like make telephone calls, contact people, spin around a laundry, quick bit of breakfast, quick bit of lunch, and you know, move on again.
When I was homeless, I used to go in there at 10 o'clock when they first opened, and I'd have a shower, and then they'd let me use their computers, you know, like to build a CV and stuff like that.
also I could have food. I could have two meals a day, so like lunchtime and dinner time.
I'll go down there because it's being surrounded by other people that want to be sober and are on the same journey as you. Some may be a year sober, some may be 5 years, or you get people with days like myself, so everyone supports each other. It's got to be structure to get off the drink for me.
And the job centre, as always, was pushing me a little bit, as with everybody else, to go find work. And they said to me, had I tried Aspire? I thought, oh Christ, another bloody hoop to jump through just to keep these people happy. Okay, I'll go. Having walked in the door for my first time, I felt at home immediately. So I came to work here on a supposedly a two-day-a-week basis.
The ARP was an option. It's the Alcohol Recovery Project. I did actually take full advantage of the service provided, engaged with AA meetings, one-to-one support from a key worker.
Basically, when I turned 16, I went to the council to ask for some help in regards to housing. They turned me away. They didn't even take a form. And they said, oh, you could go and see BIP. I decided that I'd go and see BIP after pondering upon it for some time. A man called Dave came down the stairs and welcomed me. He filled in forms with me, did risk assessments with me, and was fantastic. Within 24 hours, I was in the foyer. That didn't quite work for me because of the situation that I was in at the time in my mind and my mindset. So I left there, trying to find another route into getting a house, being impatient and expecting everything straight away, as everybody does.
They moved me to a religious rehab. So when you're coming off on drugs, you get subutex or methadone or other drugs, but they don't give you no drugs there. When you're cracking, they pray over you. That's how they deal with it. So when I got there, I got a bit nasty. I goes, look, I think I need to go back to Oxford after night. And I goes, nah, this ain't working, mate. This ain't going to work. I need to go back. And they goes, look, well, you can't just give it a try. I goes, look, mate, you better let me go back, because I'm going to really make it bad for everybody.
Then I've just went back into a habit of heroin and drink and what you need to do just to survive on the streets, you know. And they want you to jump through all these hoops, you know, and you've got problems.
You've either got to agree to be totally sober or drug-free or whatever to get anything. But then so many people have been on drink and that, where they've been on the streets so many years, it's hard for them to just stop like that.
I've had to research myself what is out there. It's not very well signposted, and it can be quite hard to find out what help is available.
The main challenge is social, to try to be socially included. You know, because you feel exclude. Not part of the main, I suppose, until you get your own place, part of, I don't know how to say it, normality.
Coming from a nice house with cars and a good job, where money was never an issue, go from that to living on £70 a week is very difficult.
When I stopped drinking through the help of Alcoholics Anonymous, it tipped my husband over the edge because he didn't want me to stop drinking. So by this point, our house was on high alert, so that if I was to phone 999, the police would know to come quickly to the house.
Again, I went to the Banbury Council. They again turned me down. I was 17 at this point. And they said I'd have to wait until I was 18. And even then, with my conditions, that I would still have to wait, as they had a 10,000 people waiting list.
Unfortunately, along this line, where I was staying, which was my ex-partner's place, the court decided also that I didn't ought to be there, and I found myself homeless.
So he started getting physical and pushing me around, screaming and shouting. I just felt I needed to get out. So I got myself into the downstairs toilet with my boys and phoned the police. And the police came really quickly, and from that moment it was brilliant, because I got into the car with a few documents that I was told to take, and I walked out of that house and I thought, I never have to go back there again. I never have to see him again.
After about a week of being back in Oxford, the men found me outside the St Aldate's Church. They found me, and but they let me go. I go, look, I don't want to do it no more. I just don't want to do it no more. So, and then the money that I owe you, I'll have to pay you that back. But they let me go. They made mates to me. They were completely opposite to me as well. These are people, they were studying. They got jobs as well and all that. They're just different to me. But I started hanging around with them, going out with them at night to feed the homeless. And I went to Cornwall. But even while I was there, I was still a bit, because I'm not having any drugs now. I've just stopped. I've gone from taking ecstasy, snorting coke, and drinking a bottle of vodka a day to not having nothing. But it was so beautiful, you could see every single star in heaven, all the stars, because there was no light pollution. And as horrible as I could be to them, they didn't say go away. They just kept praying. I don't know how, but somehow I don't drink. I just don't want any drink. After a few weeks, I didn't want drink no more. I just didn't want it.
Again, a year later, I went back to BIP. And they helped me yet again, put me in the foyer. I was very resistant. I didn't want to go in the foyer. I wanted a house automatically, but came to realise very quickly that that doesn't happen. So I stuck with it three more times, getting my washing done at BIP, getting food supplied by BIP, and generally just having their help and counselling and going down there for something to do when it was cold.
So when you become homeless, your world has fallen apart in a sense. So first of all, it's to try and, for me it was to understand what had happened. So people had to explain it to me. You know, the support workers taking it very slowly is, they liaise with the local authorities and try and establish in writing what's happened. It's also very complicated to be homeless. It's not, you can't just roll up and say you're homeless. You have to prove that you're homeless.
Whatever council did ask me, whatever proof they wanted, I tried to give them. And even Asylum Welcome did help me. Refugee Reserves did help me. I get the letter from my doctor. I got the letter from the people that know me. I have been working. And even I got all my old tenancy, everything they asked, I give them. But still they didn't accept my local connection.
The last time I went to BIP, they said to me, we will help you again. They extended their hand to me after I had effectively thrown egg on their face. And come out of the foyer so many times after them helping me. I was shocked by this because I hadn't found such kindness before. Basically, I agreed with them that if they put me back into Bambi foyer one last time, I would stick it out, and I did.
Because I was a joint home owner when I lived with my husband. It was a kind of full investigation into, did I make myself intentionally homeless? But as soon as the local authorities started talking to the police, they realised, no, I didn't do that, and the background was fleeing domestic abuse. In some ways, I was more fortunate than other people because of the complexities of my children's needs, we didn't have to go through a hostel system because it wasn't deemed suitable.
I was given a key worker and I had to attend to see her once a week to adjust my support plan. From that support plan, you're given the choice of whether to go into the bedsit, which is where you have to start, and then move into a flat within the facility. And that's when you start to pay your own electricity bills and other bills so that you can prove that you're able for a house.
They were so professional. They really, really helped me in every area of my life. They helped me apply for benefits. They helped me to go to solicitor's office. They helped me to liaise with social support services.
Eventually, after I'd proven my time in the foyer, the council started to listen after BIP and connections. I got my first house in 2009. And from then on, I've just moved up the chain with a lot of support.
I had to find somewhere to live. So that was the same trouble I was in years ago before when I just come out, when I got to the place in Kirby. But we're in a different space now. I'm with the church. So one of the guys that I'd met there, Jez, he now works at Turning Point. We've got a place in St Clement's with the church, and one of the guys paid the deposit.
What really paid off was my prior pushing to the council, coupled with my support worker from Aspire really getting on the case. And as a joint effort, we got the place I've got now, albeit in an old folks home, but then I am an old folk, so therefore what am I supposed to do?
I actually live in sober living, which is my choice, where I can't drink. So if I drink on my tenancy, then I'll be kicked out, which is good because that's how badly I don't want to drink. It's more independent. I mean, I do have like my own kitchen and stuff like that because I am an independent person now. And they'll only take you on as long as you're proactive, as long as you're engaging in services. I go to Crisis. I come to Aspire sometimes. I do voluntary work. You know, I actually have a plan.
After about 10 months sharing a bedroom with my parents, we got a letter onto the floor saying we were going to be housed and helped. And it was a wonderful relief.
And then I was going to church, and as I said, I was going out on the street, feeding the homeless. I met a girl as well from the church, Catherine, who was really brave. She had an MA, and she didn't smoke cigarettes, she didn't drink. She'd never been to a disco.
The local charity had provided bags of food and sort of things like bedding and knives and forks, things like that. And we couldn't get over the fact that there was like chocolate biscuits, because it was like something really special, like we were worth something special.
Having a home to go to is one of the biggest blessings in my life alongside God. And I just feel that without that, I'd be nothing. I wouldn't be able to wash my clothes and be presentable or get a job.
How could I be so lucky? I kept saying to myself, you know. 3 months ago I was selling drugs, selling crack and heroin. Now look, I've got to live in St Clement, got myself a nice girlfriend, and don't drink anymore. I'm not on heroin or crack anymore. When you have a girlfriend, you like to take her out and buy her things and stuff like that. So I didn't like it. I hated it. I hated it. That I wasn't doing crime, so I didn't have any money. And I hated it that she was working and she had money and I didn't have any money. I didn't feel like a man. I felt impotent. That's how I felt. I actually felt impotent.
and I ended up taking heroin. What was I feeling bad about? You might say you're living in St. Clements, you've got a girlfriend, but I didn't have a job. I didn't know where was I going to get a job from. I didn't know what was going to happen in the future. Where am I going from here? After a while of not getting in trouble, things get scrapped. But because I've done firearms, that's for life. It will never get scrapped, taken off. I'm black as well. You know, so for me to try and go and get a job as well with a record like that, I kind of half stand no chance, don't I?
When I moved into the accommodation, like my key worker, she came with me to meet the housing association and discuss all the practical things about how to cope with this house. And then for weeks and weeks afterwards, she would come to the house and say, you know, how's it going? Are you managing your money? Are you feeling okay? And that was invaluable support, because as it was, when we first took on the accommodation, I got very depressed. And I think it was just everything kind of flooded in of what had happened. And then I'm kind of left looking at bare floorboards and a big house thinking, now what?
And I had to admit it to her. I had to say, look, I've took on some drugs, hard drugs. And that's when we had to start getting some help. I just realised I had to get off the drugs, I had to get myself clean. And I went into Simon House. And I wasn't drinking anymore. I wasn't involved in crime anymore. So I decided, I thought, right, you know what I want to do? I'm going to try and help people. You know, I want to help people like myself. So I applied to Ruskin College to do a health and social care course.
I started to attend Crisis Skylight, and they've been fantastic. They run courses about self-esteem and how to believe that you have a worthwhile place in the earth, whoever you are, and that your past doesn't need to dictate your future.
Ruskin College said they was a bit worried. They said they're worried about me being on the subutex and the work. Maybe it might be too much pressure, and they're also worried that I might sell the students drugs on that, with my background. So they said, get yourself off the subutex and come back. I was quite actually that was focusing. I was saying, this is the path I'm going to take now. So when that happened, it was like pulled the rug from under me. So it was going a bit bad again. Not bad, I wasn't back in crime at least, but I'd run up the rent bill. So I then decided to myself, shake yourself up a bit, you've let slip again, you're sliding again. So, and I'm suffering from depression, and that's why I'm smoking more weed to try and make myself feel better, and it's just like that. So what I need to do is I need a job.
In our country, it's like if you're a white male and you're over 30, you can just deal with life and just deal with that. That's not the case, that. And like I say, I know that I can fend for myself and that, but mentally and that, it's draining.
People are homeless because they have issues. It's not that people are being lazy and are just drinking and taking drugs. You know, a lot of it's domestic violence, abuse, vulnerable people. People need help, and people don't see that. They think, homeless people, junkies, drinkers, whatever. And what they don't realise is people drink because it's self-medication.
It is a fact that homelessness quite often goes hand in hand with addiction, mental health issues, and people do stereotype. The media don't help. There's never any sympathy in the media for homelessness, really.
We have stigmas around people that claim benefits, people that are not working, people that are in social housing. It's so sad because I want to have a place in society. Everyone wants to be needed and wanted.
But all homeless people do not sit on a wall drinking cans of cider all day. Some people are out there, you just have to look around this building. People are getting education, people are doing hobbies, art, getting into theatre. And getting back into the system and helping other homeless people.
And my next step is I got the solicitor and he's trying to just get my local connection. Maybe they let me I go to night shelter because I'm sleeping rough. Yeah, I just wanted to know what's going on, you know? Why council doesn't accept my local connection? If I am not from Oxford, where I come from?
I've been here twice before, which is, like I say, this has got to be the last time now. If it's not like places like this, it's fend for yourself, basically. And I've still got friends in Banbury sleeping on the floor themselves.
Keep myself as busy as I can. At the minute, 4 days a week at Aspire. On the day off, Tuesday, I volunteer at the food bank. It's, for me, the most important thing is routine and regularity. Trying to stay away from the life that I used to live.
Yeah, I'm going uni in October, so that's what makes me happy, really. Just, I like to achieve things. Youth and community degree. I'm young enough, hopefully, to turn that around, so I want to stop now.
At the County Police Station, I went there to them and said, look, you know who I am, and that, you know, you've been chasing me for years and that. I would like to start going into schools and talking to the young'uns I'd like to, about drugs and what it's like in prison and the importance of the education, and if they're getting abuse at home they feel they can't tell no one, that, you know, you need to tell someone at school or say something, you have to speak and that. So the police liked the idea of it and said, yeah, we'll pay you £75 a go.
Because I talk about writing and show my writing with my key worker, he suggested that myself and another member might like to kind of facilitate a creative writing group. It's about expression, making sense of experiences, coming to terms with things that have happened, or just enjoying something.
I do still find it challenging, but not to be scared to ask for advice and go to places where I wouldn't have done. I thought I was all be alone, but I'm not now.
Yeah. A vacancy occurred. I applied and became a two-day-a-week assistant leader, which now has progressed to a full-time staff member. I've come through the unemployed to being fully employed and quite happy, been very happy in fact, working where I am. I feel I've probably wasted 4 or 5 years of my life not knowing this fire existed.
In 6 months' time, if I've not had a drink, they'll put me forward for a council property, which I should be successful. I mean, yeah, it's extreme in terms of 10 months. 10 months ago I was sleeping in a bin and now I'm on my way reintegrating back into society.
I'm married and things are a whole lot better. My mum and I are getting on now and things are pretty great.
I've just gone from strength to strength from there. I've just kept working, making sure eating, stay away from, you know, not involve myself with criminal elements and here we are.
Thank you.